It's been a long day. It's been a long week and a long few weeks. And so in sitting down at this point, I ask you to take a deep breath, to ask God's Spirit into your heart and into your mind, that you may be guided into God's kingdom and into anything new that God may be at work at in the world around us. I'm about to show you a clip. And in showing you that clip, I would ask you to think about what comes to mind. Do you agree? Do you disagree? Do you think about things in it that maybe you've never thought about before? This is Considering Race, the second session, and we'll begin with a clip from BuzzFeed News.
Some people are born into families where they have to walk miles just to get water. All I have to do is turn on a faucet. That's privilege.
If you have ever tried to change your speech, if you were embarrassed about your clothes or house, if you would never think twice about calling the police or trouble with them.
I think privilege is when some people have some things and other people don't have things.
I feel privilege is something that you don't even really have control over.
I think it'd be silly for me to say I don't have a fair amount of privilege, considering like the country I live in and the job I get to do and the college I was allowed to go to.
I suppose being a white male will help me end up somewhere towards the front, but I'll take a few steps back from being gay.
I don't think I'll make it to the front. I think I'll maybe be in the middle. That's just the gut feeling I have.
If your parents work nights and weekends to support your family, take one step back. If you can show affection for your romantic partner in public without fear of ridicule or violence, take one step forward. If you were embarrassed about your clothes or house while growing up, take one step back. If you have ever been diagnosed as having a physical or mental illness or disability, take one step back. If you have ever been bullied or made fun of based on something you can't change, take one step back. If you get time off for your religious holidays, take one step forward. If you came from a supportive family environment, if you can see a doctor whenever you feel the need, if you are able to move through the world without fear of
sexual
assault,
if you took out loans for your education,
if there were more than 50 books in your house growing up. So these are your final positions.
I think it felt kind of strange for everyone.
It's a hard thing to discuss or even reflect on.
It was very awkward.
I think when you can represent it so visually like this and so immediately, it definitely takes on a new form.
I think we were like all joking around in the beginning. It was pretty lighthearted. And as soon as the questions started coming in, the mood shifted immediately and we all kind of, it was just silent.
Just looking back and seeing like a bunch of people behind you is not a good feeling.
It's like weird how you want to like hold on to explaining a certain privilege. Like, oh, but that's not actually me because like I had to work really hard for that. So it's weird to like take a step forward when you feel like you're taking a step forward with someone else, but you wear a lot of the baggage of like how those things were hard.
It was like more emotional than I thought it would be.
It reminded me of when they talk about slavery in high school and you feel like angry for a few days, but then you just realize like, this is how it is.
For me, it was kind of frustrating almost to look back and see how much further some people were behind me and realizing that, you know, a lot of that stuff, no amount of hard work or even legislation can make up that gap.
It's interesting being an Asian American because you kind of, you're not really sure where you fall on the spectrum of privilege.
I know that for me, one of the reasons I ended up so far back was that there are questions around safety as an African American, as a woman, as a gay woman. There are just so many different ways that I don't feel safe.
I feel like I just learned to be grateful for what you have. You know, we're in such a huge society where it's always complaining about what you don't have.
It just shows you that for some families, like each family, you're meant to do better. My grandparents did good, my parents did good, and I'll do even better.
I do think if you're not like aware of privilege, you should do this exercise, but it's more complicated.
So at this point, I don't want you to have made any judgments. I don't want you to have leapt or gone to any conclusions. I just want you to sit with the idea that privilege may be a thing that some people have felt. And I want you to think about how you feel about this. And I want to begin to open the possibility that the world of COVID-19, the world of chaos that we currently live in, the descent into darkness, and having Reformation Sunday in front of us is a call to death and resurrection, to reformation. And I would just like you to sit with the idea of how privilege may look or feel, to note what your objections or your feelings are and where you sit with that. In a moment, I'll move into a Bible study portion of this video. And what I would like for you to do is just note what you felt, note what you're thinking, note any questions, any skepticisms, whatever you have, make note of those and hold on to them. I would like for you to read or at least look through the article that I will attach here or send out with the email. I would like for you to pause this as I get into section 2 where it says the Bible study. Pause there, and before you do that, read or look through that article that I've attached or put down in the description, to sit with that for a moment and to begin to pray about where the world might be moving in a new direction or being reformed, where God might be guiding us. So at this moment, all I've asked you to do is set aside your busy day and life to take a breath and begin to reflect on what's going on around us and begin to develop a faithfulness or a hopefulness of what might be going on around us, but what God might be doing, to reflect on who you are in relationship to it, and to just sit with it for a moment and set it aside while I spend some time with Scripture. So this is the second time that we're meeting under the guise or under the study that I've entitled Considering Race. I will try to card to the previous one here if you're interested in what we talked about or how that went. At this point, though, I'll start the Bible section of this study the same way I started it last time. Think of the stories of the Old Testament. Think of the stories of your childhood. Think of the stories that are so rich that come towards the beginning of the Bible. Think of the stories of Sunday school or the stories that you've heard in church for your whole life. What stories of the Old Testament come to mind? Among those, somebody, if not all of you, considered the Moses tale, the tale of Moses. And I'm calling that a tale here because I want to consider what it means as a sort of paradigm. I want to think of it more as a narrative and as a story and what it says about being human, and how the Bible speaks to God's interaction with humans. And I want to think in particular of the Moses tale. A tale. I'm trying to make it more paradigm and less historical, which is a move away from how we sometimes think and sometimes approach the Bible. A move away from historicity and into story. Okay? In Exodus chapter 1 and 2, part of the full story of Moses' legacy becomes into view. It's in Exodus chapters 1 and 2. It comes into view here, where Moses finds himself, after having for a while been in relationship with, now in conflict with Pharaoh. And when I ask you to think like a paradigm instead of like history, instead of reading the Bible as history, but reading it more as a paradigm or a story that's meant to challenge us or cause us to think, I want you to look this up. I want you to have your Bibles and to literally look at this. The story of Moses, as it
begins at this point to unfold as an opposition to Pharaoh, does not name Pharaoh. It says Pharaoh, which is an almost generalized term. It's a term for a ruling class, for a sort of stasis, or a sort of condition, a ruler, and for something that Moses now finds himself in opposition to. Remember that I'm wanting you to think of this less as history and more as a paradigm for us to adopt and hear our own voice in the story. Look at Exodus 1 and 2, chapters 1 and 2, and notice that where it says Pharaoh, there's not a name listed. Incidentally, the story as it unfolds in Exodus, this famous story of Moses in the Old Testament that comes to mind, that has to do with the Exodus and going through the Red Sea and death of Pharaoh's firstborn, is sort of perplexing if we stay just with history. It's perplexing because there is no listing of any Pharaoh ever coming into some kind of conflict like this, or losing their child this way, or all these plagues. We have all or a lot of the records of Egypt, and this story just isn't there from their end. Of course, they might want to hide it, but if something this big happened, I think they would want some history. There would be some way for this to have been told. In reality, what this probably is a pretty small band of people who are coming up against a stuck way of thinking, a way of safety that isn't as safe as it seems and that uses people. And they're coming up against it, and they're being people whose lives and whose stories are being thrust into change or into freedom or into God's liberation. In the Egyptian record, we do have a note of Hapuru, that there were some small group, clan of people who they did enslave, and they call them the Hapuru, and it is likely that they really meant Hebrew, like the Hebrew people. And so that's sort of where we're at, and that's where we're at with the historicity of this. And I want you to think about this. The story of Pharaoh and the story of the institution that he has come to symbolize, the culture or the society that he has come to symbolize in this story, could go back as far back as Genesis chapter 12. So if you flip back to Genesis chapter 12, you'll see the start of this power or this institution or this thing. And you'll notice there that what's spoken about is the vastness of Pharaoh's resources, that the supply is unending because of where they're located geography, that they geographically, that they have a lot of power because of what they can grow or own, that it's a lot to do with ownership. There's also a story all the way back in Genesis chapter 12, if you look at verses 10 through 20, that begins to talk about how that ownership gets perpetuated. I preached a number of weeks ago about locks, that once you start owning stuff, you also need to design locks to keep it. In this case, when you start owning stuff, you have to begin to start confiscating other stuff to protect and keep your thing. This is the way society goes. It's like being taxed, right? So this is where we're at back in Genesis 12. I'm going to leap from there to Genesis 41. In Genesis 41, we're told of Pharaoh, and we're given insight into the institution that, though it seems like it's big and protecting us and stuck in one place and presenting stasis, the anxiety on Pharaoh's shoulders in Genesis 41 verses 1 through 7 starts to really become clear. He has nightmares in his sleep about scarcity. He has all this abundance in real life, so much abundance that he's begun to take on more and more of a position of confiscating so that he can perpetuate that safety that he's built. But at night, anxiety comes out. I don't remember much from college, but I remember in college, I took a personal finance class, one of the most helpful classes I've ever taken. And I remember in particular that the professor of that class showed us a study. Now, this study's old now, but it's always stuck with me. And it has to do with people's income. And the idea was that every income bracket basically always says if they would just make 10% more, they would be okay. This is the problem with institution and with Pharaoh and with what Pharaoh represents. And again, I'm not wanting you to think about this just as history. I'm wanting you to think about it as a story that you begin to fall into, right? The kingdoms, institutions, governments, cultures, while they present safety, present that safety at cost. Anxiety for the people who are running it, and a confiscation or built upon the backs of people. And Moses in this story, as his story begins to come alongside this story of Pharaoh, begins to become one of desiring freedom. In Exodus chapter 1, so we've now moved from Genesis, we've been in Genesis chapter 12, we've been in Genesis chapter 41. I'll also mention to you that in Genesis 47, the Hebrew people begin to sort of be co-opted by Pharaoh. They begin to become a part of the machine, the big structure that is Pharaoh. You can see that in Genesis chapter 47. And now we're able to move to that part that I really wanted to have you look at, which is Exodus chapter 1. In Exodus chapter 1, Pharaoh, again, not listed historically, but as a cipher, as a symbol in some ways, becomes more and more ruthless. His supply chain is huge, but as he pulls more people into it to sustain it, it needs more, and it's sort of unquenchable, and it's unsatiable, and it sort of has to co-op other people, their feelings, their emotions, their own experiences, and pull it into Pharaoh, into the institution. And by this time, the Hebrew people have been pulled in, and Moses is part of the Hebrew people. There's a co-opting that's begun to happen, and the break happens when Moses chooses his identity or his experience over the anxiety and the sort of safe but really kind of problematic structure of Pharaoh, right? I'll quote here and I'll put up behind me Exodus 1, verses 13 and 14. I'll have you look at those, and I want you to keep thinking about this. I'll make a couple of notes. Pharaoh, Egypt, represents totalism. It represents culture. It represents being subsumed and co-opted. And I'm not speaking just historically here. I'm also speaking how we ourselves fall into this story. I want you to think of it as a narrative. For example, African American slaves very, very, very strongly identified with this story of Moses. It talks about slavery that is similar to their slavery as the people of Israel or Hebrew people, because Israel isn't there yet, begin to be co-opted. They begin to fall into slavery. They have their backs become the ones that this unsatiable totalism is being built on. And African American slaves very rightly knew how to interpret this text properly. I would contend that in today's world, where we're taught this story in Sunday school, but we kind of forget about the full structure of what's going on, and we make it history, you and I, most of us white, have lost the vibe and the feel and the very spirit of God in this text. But that African Americans, during the time of slavery, and even now that they still cite this, really know the spirit of this text in a way that you and I don't. In Moses, we see that success, a movement into God's presence, is a departure. We begin to see that faithfulness is a departure from totalism. Christianity is, and it is always meant to be, a humble self-critique of who we are. In terms of our Lutheran heritage, it is a reformation, and it is a constant reformation. Lutherans say that we don't just celebrate the Reformation of 1517, but that the Reformation is always happening and always a part of who we are. In 2020, especially in terms of what we see in the news, we can put this in the angle of race. We can see this as part of the narrative of race, African Americans, I would contend, have used this text better than you and I as white people. And it's time for us to begin to think about the privilege in hearing this as a quaint little history story instead of living the life of needing to feel like totalism doesn't include you. It's total for everybody else, but not you. And to begin to feel how reformation or a break with totalism is what success or what faith sometimes is. That faith is self-critiquing and totalism doesn't allow for that. In Exodus 2, 11 through 15, the story results in a violent break. There's all these plagues, and there's disaster, and there's conflict. And often, because of the conflicts, totalism, Pharaoh, doesn't like conflict. To keep its supply chain going, it needs its effort put there. So that doesn't like this. So in Exodus 2, 11 through 15, this violent break is hard, and I would say that it's hard for us. We are afraid of a violent break. And so it's easier to be co-opted and part of the feeling of safety, even though we might know in our guts it's not all the way right. The break from it is a challenge because that break feels like it's going to be violent. Haiti, the nation of Haiti, is the only nation in the entire world in which slaves successfully revolted against their slavers. It happened in our hemisphere. It happened not that far from our own southern shores of Florida. And the issue there was is that that did involve violence. And when we turn on the news, part of what scares us away from considering race or being people who critique ourselves on race is that we, like it or not, fall into this category of privilege and totalism and Pharaoh. And I would contend in doing so, we've lost the spirit of the Bible story. And that's what I'm hoping that we hear and what begins to come through. I'll remind you again that African Americans really, really identify with the story of Moses. It's, I would say, it tends to be their favorite text in the Bible. I've never visited a black church when this text or this story wasn't referenced. And it's not just because they like telling history stories. It's because they identify with it. And I would contend that identifying with this text is more important than having it be a quaint Sunday school story. The story of Pharaoh is one of totalism, of unsatiable safety that also brings anxiety and its own emptiness and that co-opts other people. And Moses, the story of God's becoming a relating God, is a story of breaking from that. And I know what a scare that is. I know what we're afraid of, and I know the violence and the upheaval that scares us. And I guess I would just throw out there that the violence and the upheaval is in its own way a call back to faithfulness. You and I can't really provide our own safety. That's a lie or a misgiving of totalism and of Pharaoh. That safety isn't really is wrapped up in this as we might think. That we don't control our own safety. We're afraid of the violent break and getting to the other side. And Moses and the people who have identified with that story more closely, the black church, become a great example for us of what our faith is supposed to be. A faith that isn't put off by violence because we know that God protects us and God keeps us. Violence is a true threat, but it's no less present in Pharaoh, where slaves are being whipped, than it is in what we're afraid of in the break, right? So this is a little bit of a working through of Pharaoh and some of the background of that story that we've made such a big part of ourselves. We teach it in church, but I don't know that we teach it like this. And so I wanted you to sit with it for a few minutes, and I appreciate your faithfulness to do so and your faithfulness to allow me to introduce some ideas that maybe you haven't heard and to open the door for some self-critique. In Exodus 24, verses 3 through 7, God makes a covenant on the other side with Moses' people, with the people of Israel. That covenant is a connection to God and a rejection of Pharaoh, of the gods, of the safety, of all the things that Pharaoh represented. And this isn't necessarily a historical thing. The going through the Red Sea, where is it in archaeological evidence? Where is it in the story of Egypt? It's a thing that probably happened for a small group of people. I believe Moses is real, and I believe this is the roots of the people of Israel, but it looks different than we think, and it's not just a historical thing. It's a way that God lives in our midst. Now, it is super easy for us to be co-opted. The story of co-opting is a back and forth yo-yo, and it is so easy for us to fall into it, and that's the thing that I want to critique. That our co-opted totalism looks just like the world around us. Faith is what God is always calling us to die to and be resurrected. That's what's happening in the story of Moses and Pharaoh, and it happens elsewhere in the Old Testament. I'll take a few minutes to share with you from this book by Walter Brueggemann, where I will share with you another way that this co-opting has happened in Scripture. I would like for you to think of Solomon. Now, Solomon is a character that maybe not as much as Moses is part of the kings of Israel that we sometimes teach in church. We for sure talk about David. Solomon comes thereafter. If you think of the book of Ecclesiastes, for everything there is a season, that's a wisdom movement that's attributed to Solomon. And by the way, I would contend that when you read Ecclesiastes, you can see totalism, and you can see fatalism, and you can see what happens in a world where supply has been given to a lot of people. It's a lot of boredom. It's to each their own. This may happen to me, this may happen to me. Oh, well, it's a sort of being resigned and removed from the passion. And by the way, the word passion connects to Jesus and is supposed to connect to our faith. Wisdom is a different feeling than this passion. Anyway, I'm going to reference a few things here. I'm going to do it in short order to show how this co-opting is a theme that goes throughout the Bible. It's into Jesus' life, of course, but I'm now moving to another part of the Old Testament. I'll reference this up here. Solomon, trying a move towards totalism. Remember, he's a person whose heritage is Moses himself. And he's now come into the Promised Land as people. They've established their own kingdom, and now he's trying to compete as Pharaoh instead of owning the depth and the reliance upon God that's supposed to be part of the story. In 1 Kings 11, 1 through 3, we're told that Solomon has a harem. This is a big thing in the ancient world that has to do with political marriages, and it also has to do with a demonstration of power to all the other kingdoms around you. Solomon, the people of Moses, the Hebrew people, start to fall into or be co-opted by the feeling that we have to have totalism or safety. Solomon, and this is told in 1 Kings 4, 7 through 19, sets up a system of tax districts. When the tax districts are sent up, they wipe out the clans and the tribes that have their own practices and their own identities, and a more universal or totalistic regime is set up. In 1 Kings 4, 1 through 6, and then it's referenced again in 1 Kings 9, 23, Solomon has a huge bureaucracy, a bureaucracy that is bureaucratic for its own bureaucracy, for its own self-sustaining. And this begins to move away or be co-opted away from the passion or the fullness, the break that God had called Moses to. In 1 Kings 4:4 and 1 Kings 9:22, we see that Solomon has built a standing army. Again, an unsatiable thing that's built upon itself and that needs to keep supplying itself, that needs to employ or use to build up its own feeling of safety, to threaten, oh, we're keeping you safe from violence, but really to be muscle that it could be involved in more violence. In 1 Kings 4, 29 through 34, and in a few other places, we see that Solomon becomes fascinated with wisdom. This is an imitation of all the great, powerful regimes around him, but it's also this sort of freedom to rationalize reality, to sell your totalism to other people, and to maybe make it less of a heart thing and more of a head thing. Remember, though, this is the very thing that Pharaoh represented to Moses and that Moses was trying to break from. And eventually this will be the thing that Jesus, the new Moses, has to help break the Hebrew people and eventually Christians from. This is our heritage. This is what it's built on. This is our story. To close out this section, I'll also tell you that in 1 Kings 5:13 through 19, Solomon ends up conscripting labor from villages to support massive building projects. That should sound a heck of a lot like Pharaoh, and you should begin to hear again a bit of the issue of conscription, slavery, lack of freedom for some to build the illusion of totalism, where really who's benefiting from that? The point of all of this, if you're still with me, is to see biblically that the danger that you and I risk in terms of our faith is being co-opted. You and I are not really, as people of faith, the same as all the people around us. But it's really easy for our lives to begin to look like this. Now, put that together with this thinking from the first part of this video about privilege. Put that together with the idea that we're afraid of a violent break because it's easier to just stay with the system we have. Put that together with the article from USA Today that I've referenced that talks about where the system is, and you can begin to see how easily we have been co-opted into a culture, and we've become sometimes, oftentimes, a people more like Pharaoh and Solomon than like the other side of the ledger, Moses, and maybe even sometimes Jesus. And then you can get to the heart of why I'm talking about this. Yes, it's an issue of race, but even more important, and well, race and class, I'll say, but even more important, it's an issue of the real dynamism of our faith. Our faith has become a static thing. And today, I would like for you to think about that. And to not just accept privilege or accept Pharaoh or totalism, but to begin to understand that faith is a call to humble self-critique, and that it's always a sort of tool that's supposed to reform and reform itself over and over. We are very afraid of this reform and this violence. We blame each other when it's something that's around us. When we feel stressed, we start sending out emails to this person about this person, and we sort of eat ourselves alive. And when we do so, we are no different than Pharaoh, and no different than Solomon, and no different from the totalism, where we're fighting and fighting to keep this safety instead of seeing ourselves in the hands and in relationship with God, who, yes, is and does represent a break with totalism, but promises that break as a way for us to actually know and experience and be embraced by the Spirit. Thank you for sticking with me. I have one more part where I'll try to wrap this up, and I appreciate your time. We'll move from here into part three. So what? What am I getting at? Well, what if this thing that we're facing, what if our times, the place where we are, the things we see on our screens, and the things that we feel in our heart are meant to be a call, a moment in which we recapture who God really makes God's people into? Prior to 2020, the church, I think, easily fell into, and we as part of the church, were easily co-opted into our own feelings of stasis and Pharaoh and Solomon. And maybe it's time that we be renewed and be reformed. This is not so much meant to be a political statement. I'm not really talking here about politics, And if you think that, I hope that you know that I'm really trying to get to a spiritual revolution, to a place where who we are as God's people is set right, and where we may be resurrected. And that, I think, is different than simply a political discussion. I'm asking if classism and racism are linked. I'm asking if racism is a problem. I'm asking if black folks have interpreted the tradition of Moses better than maybe the rest of us have, or if we've lost that interpretation, and if this isn't maybe a call back to that. To conclude, I'll offer two action steps, two things to move from reflection and into study in part two, and into where we might go from here. The first action step is that in a moment I will play, as part of this video, Louis Armstrong's version of Go Down Moses. This began as a spiritual, but it was also a retelling of the paradigm of Moses by people who understood the gravity of what's happening in the story. And it could be a moment for us to prayerfully sit with this story and know that we are being called in our day and in our time to be a part of a death of an institution and a resurrection of freedom for people of color, but really for all of us together. And so that's the first action step, and I'll play that video in a moment. After playing that video, I would also invite you to think about this content with somebody. Talk about privilege, or whether you are skeptical about privilege, or whether you think privilege exists and how that might be so, how Christians might be too co-opted into the regime of Pharaoh, and how we can be reformed and move back into being a people of Moses. Be prayerful and meditate while the music plays in a moment, and then the second action step would be for you to openly talk about someone else's take on this, what your feelings and your experience have been, and how that might interact or overlap with the feelings and experience of somebody else. I believe that in us now, God is creating a new thing. This is our spiritual reformation. This is a spiritual revolution. That's why we consider privilege and Pharaoh. That's why we consider being remade into people of Moses. And we consider what it means for us and how we might act. Enjoy the song. May it be prayerful. Remember to be in dialogue with someone else and to chat about your feelings and their feelings, and openly and earnestly be critiquing and in conversation about this. Stay safe. See you soon.
Let my people go.
He made old Pharaoh
understand.
Let my people go.
Yes, the Lord said, go down.
Go down.
Moses.
Moses.
Way down in Egypt land. Tell all Pharaohs to let my people go.
Let my people go.
Your firstborn dead.
Let my people go.
'Cause the Lord said, go down.